Record to the cloud here. And welcome. This is Central Iowa Linux Users Group. As everyone knows, we meet the third Wednesday of the month. Our website is currently down. So yes, I know the admins have been notified. I'm Andy Denner, somehow still your president. And tonight we're going to have, I apologize if I mispronounce your name. I'm terrible with all things. There you go. Presenting tonight about ButterFS. And I'm definitely very interested to hear more about his experience in being able to recover and save the day from a deleted disk. Go ahead and take it away here.
Thank you very much, Andrew. And I appreciate the opportunity to go first. My wife is not feeling well, so at some point I may have to take her to urgent care. So right now she's sleeping, so I can hopefully pull this off. You guys can hear me and can see my screen, correct?
Yep, you sound and look great.
Awesome, sounds good. So ButterFS or BetterFS, you know, the pronunciation depends on who you ask, I suppose. But it does seem to actually stand for B3 file system. And it was originally meant to replace the EXT4 file system, but also include some next generation features, including being a volume manager, RAID array manager, on-the-fly disk compression, copy-on-write, and other features. Before I proceed any further in this presentation, for those of you guys who may not know me well, which is most of you, I think, I don't have a technical background. So, you know, this is my first time presenting to this group. So, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if you find some real defects in the conceptual arena or other things. So I apologize for that. This is more going to be like a practical use of ButterFS or practical aspects of ButterFS rather than what it actually is and the internal workings of it and things beyond my level of understanding, essentially. So please bear with me and, you know, be gentle with me if possible. So in terms of talking about how this ButterFS came to be, Chris Mason is the founding developer of this file system, and he started working on it in 2007 while he was still working at Oracle. And there is some kind of like misconception, I guess, about ButterFS being still owned by Oracle. It actually isn't. It's kind of like a GPL, I guess, license. And its development currently is mostly provided, if I'm not mistaken, by the Red Hat, you know, kind of like the Fedora group, essentially. Going back to the history, ButterFS 1.0 was first accepted in mainline Linux kernel in 2009, about 2 years after its initiation. At that point, was it production ready? The answer is no. And the following message that you see on the slide was displayed, in all ButterFS installations until 2013, which is like 4 or 5 years from its introduction into the Linux kernel. It's kind of like alarming. In my opinion, you can read it. I don't need to read it to you all, I don't think. But essentially, it's stating that it's highly experimental. The disk format is not finalized. Install it or use it at your own risk. Please be ready to lose some data, you know, while you are using it. This statement was removed in 2013. Recently, ButterFS became the default file system for Fedora installations. I'm not sure I didn't install Fedora lately. Maybe I should have done it before presenting this. But there must be some kind of like a installer, you know, like tool that allows, you know, the definition of certain sub, you know, like volumes, etc., which we're going to review shortly, to make this possible. Because in other Linux installations, you know, the default installer wizard, Calamaris, I think it's called, you know, does not seem to have the option to define sub volumes during the installation, which will be the main kind of like benefit of using ButterFS, allowing some of these features. So the current state of affairs for ButterFS, it is, you know, cited as a perfectly Chromulent single disk EXT4 replacement. So, you know, it is mature enough for this purpose, but it is not mature enough to replace like ZFS, you know, as we were talking with Thomas earlier. I think, you know, people discuss about comparing ButterFS to ZFS and how fair it is and how unfair it is, etc., that kind of stuff. But many of the features that ButterFS is trying to implement has been like mature for ZFS installations. So that kind of a comparison, I think, is unavoidable. And you know, to cut the long story short, the bottom line message is ButterFS is not a ZFS replacement at this point, especially when it comes to RAID and volume management, and a simple file system that will offer all of these features at once. So what features ButterFS offers? It offers copy on write, compression, sub-volume creation and replication, snapshots, quotas, some, you know, like SSD specific features like trim feature. And also it yearns to be a multi-device file system, replacing or behaving like a RAID array or JBOD replacement, etc. I'll review these like one by one. In order, with the exception that I'll start with the last one first, because that's kind of like the weakest aspect of ButterFS at its current state. Any kind of like RAID implementation of ButterFS is considered to be not safe at the moment. So use it as a single file system, as I mentioned before, if you are going to do it. But if you are planning to use it as a like a RAID manager or multi-device file system kind of like a setup, like logical volume management kind of thing, you know, use it at your own risk, and you know, use it for stuff designed for testing and throw away data. So, you know, in other words, do not set up ButterFS in a multi-device file system manner. It is just not ready. And certain RAID modes like RAID 5 and RAID 6 are essentially coded to be fatally flawed. So do not use it, I guess. You know, if you take away one message from this presentation, I think that should be it. RAID 0, RAID 1, and RAID 10 are probably better, but again, it is not mature, and you know, expect to lose data if you're gonna use it that way. So single device use is the safest way at this point. So for the rest of the presentation, you know, everything is assumed that you are using it as a single device file system. You know, this may mean that you may have more than one hard disk, for example, or more than one device, each of which are formatted for ButterFS, but they are individual and they are not aggregated, you know, as a multi-device file system, kind of like a fashion. Now, certain companies actually use ButterFS as a multi-device file system using it as a layer on top of LVM, like logical volume management, for example. Synology is the one that I am aware of. Synology is the brand that makes some like network associated storage devices, NAS devices. They implement so-called like a hybrid NAS system, which essentially is like a patented, I guess, combination of LVM, in the bottom layer, and on top of that, ButterFS, behaving like a single file system on a logical, like a file system, I suppose, if that makes sense at all. So anyway, I have not tried it that way. There is also problem with encrypting the file system on a like a pure ButterFS situation. So the way to overcome this problem is layering the locks as a infrastructure and implementing ButterFS on top of locks, I suppose, if you want to use it in an encrypted device kind of like a scenario. I am actually using it that way on my laptop right now. And it seems to behave fine so far with an N of, I guess, 2 months, maybe, or something like that, maybe less than that, actually. So, but again, the device is perceived by ButterFS as a single device, not like multi-device. All right, moving on to the next feature, which is the copy on write. This is essentially, I may be mistaken, but introduced probably by ZFS and has been matured by that, used for all files all the time by ButterFS, unless turned off by the user. And that turning off may be done by two ways that I'm aware of, at least. Number one, you can mount the file system with the no data cow option. In the etc fstab file, or you can define the directory, specific directory, or a subvolume that the copy on write feature is disabled, and that is done by this comment here, change attribute, I think it stands for, plus c for the certain directory and or file. Pointing that. When you mount the file system with the no data cow option in the first choice, it only affects the newly created files, and cow would still apply for the existing files. When you disable cow, it will also disable compression feature of the ButterFS, and it will also disable the checksums and the detection of corrupted no data cow files. So it takes away a lot of like features of the ButterFS, which you may be using it for, essentially. However, turning off cow option is recommended for heavily updated in place files, such as virtual machine images and database stores, like the PostgreSQL data directory and stuff like that. The copy on write feature, when it is enabled as by default, will allow creating lightweight copies of any file, actually. And the way that you do that is by adding that dash dash ref link option to the regular copy command. So when you do it that way, the newly created copy of that file, I believe, only gets the metadata, but not the actual contents of the file. So copying files like this is going to have a lot less burden in terms of like wasting space in the device, if that makes sense. Please feel free to ask questions, if there's any. I am not promising that I'll be able to answer them, but I will take a shot at least, and maybe refer it to more technically talented individuals in the group. The second feature is the compression. It's a transparent and automatic compression. I believe ZFS also offers this. It reduces the size of files and significantly increases the lifespan of the flash-based media by reducing write amplification. It may improve or worsen the performance based on the use case scenario. Yes, Thomas, I'm sorry. I just saw that. Go ahead.
On the previous slide, you mentioned the copy command. Is that a ButterFS specific extension to the copy command for the ref link?
Yes, it is. So you may have to maybe update your, you know, whatever package your copy commands come from. I'm using it in Arch Linux, and in order to use ButterFS commands, there's a like a ButterFS-utils package that you need to install. And I think copy command is updated within the contents of that package. All right, sorry.
So Shane just said that it's part of the GNU copy, but it only actually does anything in ButterFS.
Oh, okay.
So you could use it anywhere, but it's not gonna do you any good. Jared has a question here as well.
Yeah, I was curious when you were talking about the copy on write stuff as well. Have you found anything that you needed to disable that for with your test machine, or have you just left it all default and it's been happy?
My Docker server, the computer that I use for like many Docker containers at home, I use that for the. For one VM, it's not a VM. I'm sorry. It has a PostgreSQL database, and I disabled copy on write on the var PSQL data directory, wherever that database survives or lives. I disabled it for that. But this is not based on my own experience. This is based on this recommendation here. So I didn't do any testing or anything that I can tell you that, well, this is better to do it this way. I'm just following the, the references that recommend, not enabling it for heavily updated in place files, as you see here. Does that answer the question at all?
Yes, it did. Jared's nodding his head over here. John is also saying that VMs, he's had some VMs that he's disabled cow as well. And other people are echoing that, yes, they've seen similar problems.
Sure.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Now, compression, we were talking about compression. Increasing the lifespan of the flash-based media by reducing write amplification, whatever that actually means, not sure. The way to enable that is, again, in the mounting option, in the FSTEP file, etc FSTEP file, you just put the compress equals to the algorithm, essentially, which may either be zlib, LZO, ZSTD, or no compression, essentially. The faster algorithms like ZSTD or LZO seems to provide better performance, and they are actually recommended as opposed to other options. But you don't have to use compression if you don't want to. I am using the ZSTD on my laptop. I can't tell you, because I didn't compare. Like using it without it, etc. But it's a fairly new laptop. It's supposed to be snappy, and it is. Would it be snappier if I didn't use compression? I actually don't know the answer to that. I can't answer that question. I'm sure some of the performance is dedicated to this, but it does not seem to, make my experience like miserable. That's all I can say, essentially. The compression size, like comp size dash x, is a command, is used to see the list of files with compression types and effective compression ratios. In ButterFS, the the conventional DU command is not reliable because it is blind to the lightweight copies that we talked about the previous slide, created by the reflink option of the copy command. So DU is gonna perceive them as, you know, like occupying the similar file space, which is not the case essentially. So it will report inaccurate data when you use it that way. The X option in the comp size command will keep the comp size in a single file system rather than looking for different file system, et cetera.
One quick question on your compression side of things. Do you know, does Z standard allow you to take dictionaries?
Well, Z standard does, but does,
ButterFS
more details on its compression settings?
Yeah, can you tweak the compression settings, do you know?
In the mounting options, you mean, or?
Yes. Shane's saying that you can tweak the level. Yes.
I am not aware of that, but it doesn't mean that you cannot.
Shane's saying he doesn't think you can specify a dictionary. Thank you, Shane.
Boy, would it be cool, though.
Absolutely. With the, you know, the advantages and disadvantages of performance, I suppose, and whatnot. But anyway, let's continue. Subvolumes. Each subvolume is an independently mountable POSIX compatible file tree and not a block device. Each BetterFS or ButterFS file system has a top level subvolume with the constant ID of 5. So that's the root file system essentially. It can be mounted as the slash or root, you know, file system by default, or another subvolume can be used as the root file system instead of this. You know what I mean? So there are several different options for the layout, including like flat, nested, complicated nested, or, you know, things like that. I don't know how clearly you can see this slide, but, this is a flat example. There's the top level, subvolume with the ID of 5. Nothing is mounted there. And the root, subvolume contains the root file system. Home subvolume contains the slash home, I guess file system. And var subvolume contains www subvolume, which is under the var directory, will contain the slash var slash www file system. Similarly, Postgres, the subvolume will be under the var directory again, and it will contain the Postgres database. And that subvolume, for example, may be disabled for cow options, independent from the other subvolumes, essentially. As opposed to the flat layout, you can actually lay out the subvolumes as you see here in a nested fashion, or, better nested version, et cetera. Each one of these layouts have their advantages and disadvantages, which is stated in this kind of like slide here. The flat layout, enables or allows the management of snapshots, especially rolling them at the beginning, is a lot easier because you create a root subvolume that contains the slash or the system, like the root sub, the file system. Whereas home, essentially, it's like very self-explanatory, I suppose. And the layout is more directly visible that way. However, all subvolumes here need to be mounted manually after they are created. That creates the challenge of installing a Linux, distro with the wizard. You know what I mean? Because this requires manual intervention. You know, if you're gonna tweak the system to your liking in a flat kind of like a layout, then you gotta kind of like do it yourself kind of thing. And wizards do not, as of now, allow this, as far as I'm aware of. Each subvolume mount points can be mounted with some options being different than others, such as no data cal or compression, so forth, etc. All right. Everything in the volume that is beneath a subvolume that has been mounted is not accessible or even visible for every user, which can be beneficial for the security, especially when you are using like snapshots. So the users will not be able to have access or they're not just going to be visible essentially to the users. So that may be an advantage or a disadvantage depending on where you are looking at. On a nested case scenario, management of snapshots, especially rolling them, may be considered more difficult as the affected layout isn't directly visible. Subvolumes don't need to be mounted manually or by F-step to their desired locations. They appear automatically at their respective locations. So this is a relatively easier way to incorporate this, the layout or creation of a bit better FS file system using like a wizard like Calamares, for example. But for each of these subvolumes, the mount options of their mount point applies depending on where they are mounted, and everything is visible. So if you are more security oriented when you are taking your snapshots, etc., that's a bad news, I guess. Every user will be able to have visibility of every subvolume that is created by the nested strategy, I suppose. Any questions? Again, I can't promise that I can answer, but all right, thank you. When to make subvolumes? Like, why should we make subvolumes, and which locations are better to create subvolumes? Well, it depends. It is the customizability of Linux, right? I mean, it is. It depends on how you mean to use them, essentially. Splitting of areas which are complete and or consistent in themselves are good locations, such as var www directory or var lib PostgreSQL directory, the database root kind of place. Slash home directory. I mean, these are like good places to create subvolumes, because they are consistent within each other, themselves, and they make logical sense because you can just take snapshots of these locations without worrying other things, splitting of areas which need special properties or mount options is another good idea to make a subvolume out of this. If you have to mount them with no data cal option, for example, like this also applies to this directory, for example, if you're gonna host a database there. Reason for creating subvolume is, for example, the var slash var slash cache directory. You don't want to include that directory in your snapshot. I mean, it's a cache folder, right? So you can create a separate subvolume for that, which will not be included when you are snapshotting your root file system. You know what I mean? So I think that's a great, actually, strategy to exclude certain portions of the file system from your snapshot slash backup strategy or plan, etc. Nested subvolumes are not going to be part of snapshots created from the parent subvolume. So this is what I was trying to say, actually, excluding parts of file system from the snapshot that is being created. That brings us with a very smooth transition, if I may, to the snapshot concept. This is the concept that I believe was also introduced by ZFS. It's simply a subvolume that shares its data and metadata with some other subvolume using the ButterFS's cal capabilities. So you just, when you take a snapshot, you created a mirror image of the subvolume of the like the parent subvolume, I should say, which will be a perfect copy of that and contain its data as well as metadata. However, just like copy dash dash reflink option, this will not spend a lot of like drive space. So therefore, it has like a huge advantage in that kind of like a department. A writable snapshot, especially, has no difference in status as compared to the original subvolume. It's a mirror image, just like rsync, for example. But rsync will mirror image the data and metadata by wasting the drive space, whereas snapshot is not going to do that. All right. The dash r option will create a snapshot that will be read-only. That's kind of like the read-only tag, I suppose. And the important aspect of the read-only snapshots is they cannot be moved. They can be deleted, but you cannot move them from one place to the other. However, you can send them, and then the receiving end, if it is also like a butterfs file system, it can receive them. You know what I mean? I think the most important two aspects of snapshots. Number one, it doesn't waste drive space. Number two, it is almost instant, just like the ZFS option. It takes maybe a couple of seconds at the most to create a copy, perfect copy of a whole file system, of your root file system, for example. You know what I mean? And if you have an external hard disk, for example, USB hard drive, as an example, which is formatted for ButterFS, you can send the whole snapshot to that file system, again, within seconds. I mean, it is amazingly fast, you know? So that is, I think that those are the two advantages of using this. To roll back a snapshot is very easy. You just need to, unmount the modified original subvolume and move it to a temporary location, and then move the, the snapshot to the original location of the subvolume. So it will, essentially restore whatever the original subvolume used to be. The exception here is if it is a read-only snapshot, you cannot do this. You cannot move the snapshot to the original subvolume space. So keep it in mind. So these are kind of like the steps to roll back to a snapshot, essentially from the modified original subvolume, right? And you can delete the temporary location that you moved that original subvolume to. Does that make sense so far? Or the alternative option is you just delete the darn subvolume. You just delete the original subvolume. It makes me a little uncomfortable, because then once the original subvolume is gone and your snapshot somehow fails, because it wasn't a perfect copy or something, I'm old school and, this whole thing, I don't feel sometimes perfectly comfortable doing this, but it seems to work as good as the other option. Then you snapshot the snapshot to the original subvolume location, if that makes sense. Especially if this is a read-only snapshot, you create a read-write snapshot of the read-only snapshot to the original location of the subvolume. That's the second option to that. Now, if you are going to rescue one directory or one file, I mean, you made a mistake like I did. You removed the Docker volume, I guess, right? Yes, a Docker volume. I just removed the Docker volume, and all I needed was to restore that Docker volume to the original place. What you can do is you can actually CD to the folder in the snapshot where the Docker volume is, and then you can just copy that volume back to its original location with this regular copy command. And this is what I did to rescue my Docker volume, essentially. Do you have a question about that?
We do have one question here. Go ahead, Jared.
Jared, can you hold on just a second, please? I have also a question here from my son. Just one second, please.
Yes.
Mom needs to go to the doctor because, of her heart.
Okay, I'll be right there.
All right, so do it.
How quickly? Okay, sounds good. So I don't know if you guys heard that, but yeah, I will just, Shane, go ahead. I'm sorry. I'll start with your question.
I was just curious. You mentioned that all the snapshot stuff uses the copy on write. Does that mean that if you've chattered to remove the copy on write, that the snapshots won't work for that item? Or does it overwrite it when it makes the snapshot?
I do not know the answer to that question.
I don't think the copy on write has any effect on snapshots. It's just whatever it was, that's what gets snapped in the snapshot, whatever it was at the time.
Mechanism.
Yeah, so under the hood, it's the same mechanism. Sorry there. So it does sound like you have to go then?
Yeah, I have to go. Let's see. I have
Okay.
How should we do this? I mean,
if you just want to send out your slides to the list here, I understand completely that you need to take care of your family, and we'll just go ahead and move on to the news here. And very worst case, this can be we can finish this up next month before we go to the next topic, and hopefully everyone there starts feeling better. And you know, there's nothing that we do here that's more important than your family.
Thank you so very much. I really apologize for this. Thank you very much. I'll talk to you guys later.
Thanks.
Okay. Well, thank you. And hopefully everyone gets the feeling better there. We'll go ahead and stop the recording then here. And we